seven valleys of Sufis, four valleys of meditation. Third is valley of stumbling blocks. This is called the valley of stumbling blocks. Once the conscience has arisen, you will now be able to see how many blocks exist. Remember, first is the valley of knowledge, and with the knowledge comes in consciousness, and with the consciousness, the conscience that has been imposed by the society, by the priest, and our day-to-day living is replaced by a different kind of conscience which is not imposed by anyone. Instead, it is born out of you. It is better to call now you live by consciousness. You are seed of awakening has dawned and you are living with that. You have eyes to see how many hindrances there are. There is wall all along. There are doors too. However, these are few and far apart. When you look at your house, there are walls all around, and doors are very few and that too far apart. If you have to walk through properly, you have to know where the doors are, where the walls are. With the second valley crossed, you will be able to see all the stumbling blocks. Al-Ghazali says there are four such stumbling blocks. The first is the temptation of the world of objects and beings. They are very fascinating. Lust is created. Why have all the world religions been saying that one has to go beyond the temptations of the world? Simply because if you are tempted too much by the world, and you hanker too much for the worldly things, you will not have enough energy for transformation. Your desire will be centered on objects and beings that you see all around. A man who wants to have a big house, a big balance in the bank, power and prestige in the world, puts all his desiring invested in the world. Nothing is left to seek God or transformation. We live in the world and the world also lives within us. You just do an experiment. One day walk through the aisles of a supermarket or a shopping mall and you will see how your eyes get attracted by all these objects and beings. Someone who is interested in laptops, mobiles, always interested in knowing what is the latest model of that. Then things like these becomes things of prestige. Remember, things are not bad in themselves. Laptop is an important mechanism. It is through the laptop and the technology we are able to communicate. Being far away in distant places, it is a necessity as far as our objective is different. Objective is the transformation of human consciousness. Then for that purpose, all that is necessary is not a stumbling block. Sufis are not against things, and I am not against technology. If we can use the technology for the, we had been using technology for the betterment of human life. If we use the technology for the transformation of human consciousness, it is better. You look at things everywhere, wherever there is a program, it is immediately followed by an app. Why we can't use this technology of developing the apps for spiritual development, the apps for meditation, the apps for prayers? But there is a problem in that. The apps for a prayer for a particular occasion will be the same. If the apps are developed, then the business-like activities of the religion will be meaningless. One who has started seeking God or his journey begins for transformation of human consciousness, the ultimate truth cannot afford them. You have a certain quality and certain quantity of energy. The whole energy has to be put into one direction. All the desires have to become one-pointed. Only then transformation can be possible. Only then you cross over the valley of stumbling blocks to reach to the next one. Ordinarily, we have many desires and desires go on mushrooming. Religious person is one who has only one desire. All of other desires have fallen into one big desire. Just as small rivers, streams and tributaries fall and become the part of the one big river. A religious person is one whose all desires have merged into one. He only seeks transformation of human consciousness. Transformation of his consciousness. He desires only transcendence. This is the tempting world. The second stumbling block is people. Attachment to people. Remember, Sufis are not against people, against family. However, one should not become attached to people, otherwise each attachment will become a hindrance, a stumbling block in the process of the ultimate flowering. Be with your man, be with your woman, be with your children, be with your friends, but remember that we are all strangers here and our togetherness is just accidental. We are travelers. We have met on the road for a few days. Maybe we will be together. Feel thankful for that. But sooner or later, ways part. Your wife dies or she goes on her own way and you will never know where or your wife falls in love with someone else and vice versa. Or you fall in love with somebody else, or your son becomes grown up and he takes his life into his own hands and moves away from you. Every son has to move away from the parents. We are together on this road for a few days. The world is final stage on which we come to act our parts. Then do the most of what he may. Or frigid claws of death may soon descend and seal your humble fate, then you shan't have time to mend. So remember this, the world is a stage on which we come to act our part. We are together on this road for a few days, and our being together is accidental. It is not going to last forever. So be with people, be loving to people, be compassionate, but do not get attached. Otherwise, your attachment will not allow your freedom to go beyond. Second type of stumbling block is attachment. The third, Al-Ghazali says, is Satan. By Satan, he means the mind. Mind is the Satan. It refers to the mind that you have accumulated in the past. Although consciousness has arisen, although you have become more conscious than ever, the mechanism of the mind is still there, lurking by the side. It is still the same old mechanism. It will continue to lurk a little longer still. It has been with you for so long that it cannot leave you suddenly. It takes time. And it waits and watches. If some opportunity is there, it will immediately jump and take possession of you. It has been your master. You have remained as a slave. The mind cannot accept that you have become a master so suddenly. It takes time. The mind is a mechanism. It is always there. For a seeker, the mind is the devil. So thinking of the devil being outside somewhere, as it is conceived by many religions, is erroneous. For a seeker, the mind is the devil. All these stories about devil are nothing else but about your own mind. The devil or Satan, as Sufis call, the devil is just a mythological name for the mind. When the devil tempts Jesus, do you think some devil is standing there outside? Don't be foolish or childish. There is no devil standing outside. The temptation is coming from Jesus' own mind. The mind says, now that you have become so miraculously powerful, why bother about other things? Why not have the kingdoms of the world, kingdoms of the whole world? You can have it, it is just within your reach. You can possess the whole world. You have so much of power. You are so spiritually high that you are full of energies. You can have all the money and all the prestige that you want. Why bother about God and religion? Use this possibility. Mind is tempting, not the devil. And when Jesus says, don't come in my way, go away, he is not talking to some devil outside. He is simply saying to the mind, please do not come in my way. I am no longer concerned with the desires that you have. I am no longer concerned with the projects that you have. I am on a totally different journey. You know nothing about it, so keep quiet. Similar thing happened when Buddha attained to enlightenment. Devil, which is known in Buddhist terminology as Mara, came with his four daughters, and tried to tempt him in every possible way. But Buddha overcome that, and this is the mind. The fourth and the last stumbling block is ego. One of the greatest stumbling blocks on the path of seeking is ego. When you start becoming a little conscious, when consciousness arises in you, you are becoming more and more alert, you start seeing these stumbling blocks. A great ego from where suddenly takes possession of you. I have become a saint, a sage, an enlightened one. I am no more an ordinary person. I am extraordinary. And the problem is that you are extraordinary already. It is true. So the ego can prove it. That is the greatest problem. Because the ego is not just talking nonsense, it is sensible. It is exactly so. Still one has to be alert that if you get entangled with ego, with the idea that I am extraordinary, then you will always remain in the third valley. You will never be able to reach the fourth, and the fourth will bring more flowers and higher peaks and greater joys that you will miss. This is the place where spiritual powers become most hindering things. The negative part is to start fighting with these stumbling blocks. If you start fighting, you will be lost in the valley. There is no need to fight. Do not create enmity. Just understanding is enough. Fighting means repression. You can repress ego. You can repress your attachment to people. You can repress your lust for things. And you can repress your Satan, your mind, but the repressed will remain and you will not be able to enter into the next valley. Only those who have no impressions, only those who have no repressions enter the fourth valley. So never start repressing, The positive part is to take the challenge that ego is challenging you. You do not take it as an enmity. Take it rather as a challenge to go beyond. Do not fight with it. Understand it. Look deep into it. Look into the mechanism of it. See how it functions. See how it functions. How this new ego is arising in you. How this mind goes on playing games with you. How you become attached to people, to things. Look into how of it with cool observation, mindfulness, with no antagonism. If you become antagonistic in any way, then you are caught. If you become indulgent, you are caught. If you become antagonistic, you are caught. And these are the two easiest things. People know only two things. Either you know how to become friends or how to become the enemy. That is the only ordinary understanding possible. The third thing will help. Be watchful, witnessing, neither inimical nor friendly. Be indifferent. Just see that they are there, because if you take any feeling attitude for or against, the feeling will become bondage. Feeling means that you become attached. Remember, you are as attached to your enemy as you are attached to your friends. If your enemy dies, you will miss him as much as you will miss your friend. Sometimes even more, because he was giving you a sort of meaning, because he was giving a certain type of meaning to your life. Fighting with him, you were enjoying a trip. Now he is no more. The ego that was being fulfilled by fight with him will never be fulfilled again. You will have to find a new enemy. So do not make enemies or friends. Just see. Be very, very scientifically observant. That is the positive thing to do. The fourth, the ego. Explore what ego is, and explore joyously. Explore what lust is, and explore joyously, meditatively, full of mindfulness. And you will be able to cross over this third valley of stumbling blocks.